I always feel a bit of a fraud in these situations, because I know that one ought to be supplying some kind of answers to the whole condition of being a screenwriter, which is what I seem to be. But I never feel I know anything you don't know.
You know, the writer is the person that everyone wishes didn't exist, really, because the public like to think the actors have thought of all these lovely lines to say. And yet, you know, there is this funny little fat man sitting in some room somewhere banging out what they say to each other.
I think Julian has a great skill at being able to take the audience with you so that they're not thrown out of the situation and think, well, that wouldn't happen. It does. And he's got a knack of knowing when to push those buttons, when to allow that to happen.
Julian has fantastic stories about his kind of overnight success in the industry, you know, something that took him 40 years to get where he was. He'd done, you know, 20 screenplays before he ever got to make the overnight success screenplay, the screenplay for Gosford Park, which is, of course, the one we all know.
Until Gosford, I just kept churning out these unfilmable, dirge-like scripts. I was just this fat, moderately successful actor coming in with a script under his arm. And I mean, if I had sixpence for every one of those. What happened was that in New York, Bob Balaban was trying to set up a film with Robert Altman. And this really is as extraordinary as it sounds. And they'd been trying to find a writer, which for some unknown reason they had failed to do. Balaban was summoned to lunch by Bob Altman, and he suddenly remembered that he had my script for the Eustace Diamonds in his briefcase under the table. So with no pre-planning at all, he said, now, wait a minute, Bob, there is this writer, you won't have heard of him, but this may be his territory. And he got the script out. And from that, I got this telephone call. I was in the kitchen on January the 1st, and I picked, hello. He says, would you like to write a script for Robert Altman? I said, yes. And that was the beginning.
Take our leisure for half an hour or so. What's this?
I believe this is my place, Mr. Jennings.
Oh. And since when did a baroness out of rank a countess? Miss Trentham, would you take the place of honour, please? Miss Trentham.
This is the scene where they're sitting down to dinner the first night of the house party, and we have this extraordinary ritual that Mary, who is a countess's lady's maid, is forced up the table into the place of honour next to the butler. I wanted to kind of remind the audience that this need for stratification, this making of rules, this making of precedents, is not something peculiar to the upper classes. It goes right through our society, this grading.
All of you whose parents were in service, raise your hand.
Only my father was.
Both, Nanny.
Not you, Dorothy.
My father was a farmer, Mr. Jennings, a tenant of Lord Carton's.
Mr. Meredith?
Factory hands, both of them. And if you ask me, they were better off.
Oh. What about you, Mr. Stockbridge? What's the matter, don't you know?
Yeah, I know what they did. But it didn't have any effect on me, on my choice of work.
And why is that?
Because I grew up in an orphanage.
I mean, I've foisted so much of this stuff onto the British public now that I think they're probably quite familiar with the notion. But Gosford, to a certain extent, reopened the argument about all that world.
Robert Altman knew that he wanted to make a particular story, a kind of upstairs-downstairs story. And Julian, who was known to Bob Balaban, the producer, was really brought in almost as a kind of historical advisor in the first instance, somebody to say whether you would have had two forks or, you know, whether you would have referred to her as, you know, madam or lady or whatever. But, of course, they got on very well, and the story of you know, how he, his first kind of proper gig as a produced writer was an unbelievably charmed one.
What was extraordinary is, I'm sure lots of you know, that trying to get a film made is the proverbial Sisyphus task of pushing a rock uphill. And it takes forever. And some of them have been going for 7 years when they get made, and 11 and so on. The funny thing about Gosford was that it was so fast. I mean, I got the telephone call in January 2000. I was on the set in March 2001. And, you know, it was released in December and I won the Oscar in 2002. I mean, that in film terms is like the Cresta Run. And of course, I didn't really know it then. I know it now much better. So I didn't have too much time to sit and think, you know, is this really going to happen? I can hardly believe it. In no time at all, Bob had moved to London and it was being cast and we were off to the races.
Oh, her ladyship.
Oh, so sorry to disturb you. Please do sit down and finish your supper. Mrs. Wilson, a major crisis has arisen. I have just found out that Mr. Weissman won't eat meat, and I don't know what to do. I can't tell Mrs. Croft. I simply don't dare.
Oh, everything's under control, Your Ladyship. Mr. Weissman's valet informed us as soon as he arrived, so we've prepared a special version of the soup. He can eat the fish and the hors d'oeuvres. And we'll have a Welsh rabbit for the game. Of course, I don't know what we're going to do about the entree, but we'll think of something. Thank you, Mrs. Wilson. 10 steps ahead, as usual. Which one of you is Mr. Weissman's valet?
I am, Your Ladyship.
Are you indeed? Yes, heavens. Thank you for your efficiency.
The picture came out and it did very well. And I won the Oscar, you know, which was extraordinary. And what I didn't realize, the first thing I won was the New York Critics Circle Award. And that isn't an envelope job. You're told you've won. You know, you go and you have a nice dinner and you do a thank you. And what I didn't realize was that the whole awards system in America, it's a season, the awards. And once you've won that, you're on the track. And from then on, you're nominated for this and this and this. Because every year they pick out about, well, the television too, they pick out maybe 10 shows and films, and out of those 10 films, the 5 nominations for everything come. And I was on that, or the movie was. And so then I won the National Critics Award, and I didn't win in Chicago, but I did win the Writers Guild and so on. And you have this kind of almost surreal period. And for me, it was extraordinary because this was my first movie. It was extraordinary. And I remember going up, I hadn't prepared a speech because I thought it would be unlucky. And also I didn't think I'd won. And I went up and as Emma and I were driving in, it was just after 9/11. And funnily enough, the simplified Oscar was not us. It was the following year. We were all big frocks and big hair, but nevertheless, this had just happened. And I remember as we drove in, we said there's going to be a lot of God Bless America tonight. And in fact, no one had said it. And I thought, I'm going to say it. Because I do very strongly feel that America rescued me. You know, all the stuff in England, this kind of stuff we have about each other, they don't care about all that. They care about, did your last picture do anything? And, you know, what are you doing next? And all that. But the other stuff, they don't care about it. And they allowed me a promotion within the business that I would not have been allowed by my British contemporaries to, at least they would never have initiated it. And so I did finish my speech saying, God bless America.
From a default position that human beings try to do good, or that they may be, some people may say they're born evil. I think in Julian's world, they try to do good. They may do wrong things, but there is a default position in the world of Downton Abbey anyway, in which people are trying to survive for their own good, and in some cases for the good of others.
I think he has such a natural instinct. I mean, he's such a wordsmith. And he has a way of using language that feels very real.
I think what he's done is been able to kind of enter a different world, a world that we're particularly unfamiliar with, or most of us are particularly unfamiliar with, that very much that upstairs, downstairs world that sort of barely exists now. But if it does, it's in the absolute rarefied bits of society. But what he does to us is give us a really interesting kind of entry point into that world, which is that he picks on particular characters. He finds kind of characteristics and paints characters that are incredibly human, incredibly that we find it easy to have empathy with, that we can really understand.
He's very generous to the directors to interpret, but it's packed, his writing is so packed with information that, you know, all the directors, the designers have what they need right in there. So I think those are his strengths. He gives you the complete picture within the body of the dialogue.
In one sense, you're getting something completely new and completely different. And in another sense, you're getting a very familiar world, you know, one with fascinating, interesting characters who are full of dilemma, you know, full of the kind of dilemmas that you and I have.
You were rather surprised to see me. I wanted to give you this. It's my lucky charm. I've had it always. So you must promise to bring it back without a scratch.
Won't you need it?
Not as much as you.
I like this scene. This is one of my favourite scenes out of Downton.
Did you have a happy time yesterday?
Because he showed Lavinia the places. They both do that thing of not saying what they're feeling, and yet it's perfectly clear.
Mary, if I don't come back,
no. What they're telling each other. I thought they both did it terribly well. Dan and Michelle. Mary, if I don't come back, no.
Goodbye then. And such good luck.
Goodbye, Mary. And God bless you.
Rather pleased at the end when she says, and such good luck. Instead of just good luck, and she's sort of on the edge.
We had at the beginning of Downton Abbey very detailed discussions about the characters and the storyline for series one, and because it had always been envisaged as a three-parter, if we were ever recommissioned. It seems funny saying that now, but, you know, of course at the time it was highly unlikely that we would get it recommissioned. And so, we were very detailed discussions working with him then. Now that it's so established and he's so sure, confident with it and with the characters he's writing for, it's more similar to the film process, oddly enough, because we don't need those in-depth discussions now because we know where it's going.
I've never worked on a show which has such an authorial voice, and I mean that not only in the script stage but as a showrunner. Bearing in mind this is probably one of the few programmes in the world of this scale, of this amount of success overseas, that is written by one person, and I think that again is one of its strengths. His hand is not only on the page, it's in the lengthy discussions about costume. I had 3 or 4 fittings over one single waistcoat because he and Susanna Buxton were discussing, and sometimes quite heatedly, the exact tone of cream or white that this particular waistcoat should be.
One of the things that I think we did right in Downton, which was a decision, although complete luck really, was to treat the servants, the family, Mrs. Crawley, the people in the village, the doctor, to treat them all with exactly the same narrative weight. So there's never a moment where you think you're going to the lesser story. You're never going to the lesser story. You're going to this story.
I think that every writer who wants to work has to bear in mind that at the end of all the money and effort, there's got to be a releasable film.
If you want to be a kind of tortured artist, go and write a book. It's much cheaper for everybody. You know, there are big numbers involved. There's big budgets involved in a screenplay business. And I think he has a sense that you have a responsibility to understand how an audience is going to react.
There is a side to you that must want to see a finished film that works. And it's no good saying, oh, but I wrote that scene for the top of the mountain, it can't be done in the bedroom. Because there is a moment where you can't go to the top of the mountain.
What he manages to do is spot what an audience wants to see, but then write it in an original way. It's not to everybody's taste. Interestingly, it is to his taste. He has said, you know, you write about what you know, but you should write about what you want to see. He said he couldn't bear to write something that he doesn't want to see.
I don't believe in theatre of alienation, you know, where you can't stand any of them. Some people do that and they can do it impressively. And you have a kind of fixated horror as you watch this drama unfold, but you don't like anyone. And I don't believe it. I don't know how to do that. I want you to like nearly all of my characters in some way or other, and even when I've got a character that you don't like much, then you give them some storyline, some aspect of their personality, and hopefully the audience thinks, oh, well, they're not as bad as all that.
The advantage of television is that you don't have to be afraid of writing for an adult audience. That the vast majority of television audiences age between 30 and death. And that allows you to have much more complicated psychological situations or narrative or whatever. It doesn't all have to be simplified. There is a tendency at the moment in film, not so much in the art house film, but in a mainstream film, to try and make it this sort of abracadabra word accessible to anyone, you know, and the minute you introduce a concept that is at all complicated or you don't suggest the conclusions that the audience should draw or whatever, then there is a slight nervousness that sets in, that you're alienating a chunk of the audience, you may lose people, the word of mouth, blah, 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 you know. And so I think the mix, which I have been allowed to have, is quite rewarding, actually.
It's almost like there's the Julian Fellowes brand. He writes about a particular milieu, he writes in a very particular way, in a very funny way, often. And I think I think he is a brand. I think that he's known for that.
Because I had success with Gosford, I then became the sort of go-to guy for subjects that involved class and Mary Poppins, because it was about a household with a nanny and a cook and blah. And I was the one in line for that. But I don't mean to talk as if the subject doesn't interest me, because it does. I think we are shaped by class, which has no moral basis whatever. It is completely arbitrary. And yet it can dominate lives. It can take away ambition. It can overpromote. It can reward talentlessness. It can suppress brilliance. All of that I find extraordinary, really.
The park is marvellous.
So pleased you like it. I do want you to feel quite at home. I'm sure you're aware why I wished you to come here. Because it would make me happier than anything. Too happy, really, if you would agree to what I wish.
And stay with you.
And stay with me.
And marry you.
And marry me.
I suppose for me, the things that interest me very much are the whole business of choice. I feel in direct contradiction of the modern fashion that everything is someone else's fault, you know, that your
childhood was ruined by this, or if you fall over in the street, it's the fault of someone. We have to take responsibility for what happened to us. And it's really almost, it's more important to take responsibility for the things that went wrong than it is for the things that went right. And you'll see that in a lot of stuff I write. And for me, the great virtue is self-knowledge. I think the more you know yourself, the more you have a true understanding of yourself and why you do things. It doesn't mean you can control them, but you can prevent yourself looking an idiot more often. I mean, I suppose my fundamental philosophy, really, is that for the majority of people, their lives are, to some degree, the result of their choices. Obviously, some people have a lot of choices and some people have very few choices, but almost everyone has some, if it's only who they marry, or do they take this job or not, or whatever. I am the opposite of the modern belief that everything is someone else's fault and that, if you fall over in the street, it's the council's fault. I don't believe that, and I don't really believe that even when it's true, it's a very creative way to approach life. I think for most of us, the more we assume responsibility for the mess we're in, the more chance we have of getting out of it.
James? Oh. Tonight.
Well, I'm sorry to drag you
One
out.
Of my other beliefs, actually, or is that we are empowered by self-knowledge. And the less self-knowledge we have, the more likely we are to wreck our lives. And that people who really know themselves are more capable of kind of dealing with themselves. And in this film is about a man, James, played by Tom Wilkinson, wonderfully, who starts the film with no self-knowledge at all. He thinks he's happily married. He thinks his wife is very happy. He thinks everything is fabulous. And in fact, he learns gradually and very painfully that this is only existing in his own head. And in fact, she's not happy at all. And when he gets there, he finally becomes stronger because he realizes the truth. And in this scene under the umbrella, he lets her go. And not in a weak way. He accepts the truth and lets her go, which, in my head anyway, empowers him. And you find that in a lot of stuff that I write, that when people admit the truth about themselves, they become stronger within the story.
I mean, I love you, and I'm on your side. And I do understand. I don't know if you think about me at all, but if you do, I don't want you to feel sad or guilty. Not anymore. I just want you to feel good about me, about us, about our time together.
I think of you.
I was always in love with film. I mean, one of the sort of funninesses about a dramatic training in Britain is you go to a drama school and the talk is all of theatre. And everything is theatre, theatre, theatre. I mean, it was 100 years ago when it was me, but I think it is surprisingly so today. Whereas, many people go into it because of film, because they've been in love with film when they were young, and that was true of me. And I had my crack at it as an actor and did, reasonably well. But what writing gave me was a kind of louder voice than I'd ever achieved as an actor.
Julian Fellowes is quite unique in the British industry. I mean, he focuses on a particular section of society that very few other people actually bother to look at, or if they do look at them, he seems to have a kind of a particular eye, a particular entree into that world that we as audiences find very appealing, very attractive.
If I have any kind of gift, it is to create characters that the public gets involved with when they're watching it, even when it irritates them. And I suppose part of that is putting likeable characters into drama. There is a sort of modern theory that you can create drama of the unlikable.
I think one of the hallmarks of Julian as a writer, certainly on Downton Abbey, is that he cares passionately about his characters. Even the ones that you may bracket or want to pigeonhole as evil or dark, he gives some great moments of surprising compassion, and I think that's one of the great qualities that I like in the script.
There is an element in the theatre where people are kind of trapped for the whole experience, whether or not they're enjoying it. But yeah, you don't really have that on television. If they're not enjoying it, they don't watch it. And I think you have to let people enjoy what you do for the most part, so that then you can have traumatic or serious elements in your story, because they trust you.
Just when you think you've got a character sorted in your head, he surprises you. Julian always constantly surprises you with the direction a character's behaviour might take them.
And I suppose that's what I strive for.
That's the story so far.